Tim's work. There we go. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship. My name is Paul Van Maren. Welcome to all of you this morning. It's good to see all of you here. How many people went to Rice Fest this weekend? All right, goodly number of you. Welcome to all of you who are guests with us for Rice Fest this weekend. Welcome to all of you who are just in town visiting family. Really glad that you're here and have chosen to be here at First Reformed Church this morning. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Say, and a special welcome to guess who? No, dads. Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day, dads. It's good to be dads. And we're going to pray specifically for our dads here in just a little bit. But also, you know, when we come to Father's Day and Mother's Day, as you know, as we did a month ago, we also just need to remember, you know, our fathers, even if they've died. And still in our hearts, there's a little bit of hurt and ache and pain. And we just want to remember to pray for, you know, those families too who are hurting and grieving as well. But happy Father's Day, dads. You know, the challenge on your shoulders is great, but in the Lord's strength, you can accomplish the task of being a father, a grandfather, and a great-grandfather. Even though your kids don't have kids at home, your job is still very great. So welcome, everyone. I want to draw your attention to this communication card inside your worship bulletin. This is an opportunity to get connected and stay connected. Even if you've been a part of First Reformed Church since the moment of your birth, this is an opportunity to stay connected. If you're new with us this morning, we're just really glad that you've come. If you're new with us, why don't you fill this out? You can bring it to the welcome table in the fellowship hall. We'll have some coffee and some goodies afterwards. If you take this to the welcome table, they have a little gift. You know, it's a little mug just to say, hey, thanks for coming here. And we trust that you've been able to taste and see and know that the Lord is good. But to stay connected as well, you can offer a prayer request. And if it's confidential, mark it confidential, and those confidential ones go only to me. Otherwise, we'll put these out on the prayer bulletin. And most of people do mark it confidential, so then that's fine. They'll go to me, and I'll keep up with you from time to time. But this is a way to stay connected and get a little bit of information at the same time. So we have a lot of things that are happening in the life of the church. Yes, this morning we do have special guests with us besides fathers. We do have the His Little Feet International Children's Choir. They're going to be sharing with us this morning in great celebration for the death and resurrection of Jesus. So right after communion, we'll have a little prayer, and then I'll welcome the kids up. It'll be a great time to celebrate what Jesus has done for us on our behalf. During that time, deacons, I'm going to need a little bit of help. During the kids sharing, we're going to have a special offering for the kids. But also, while before that, for our offering, we'll take a regular offering, but also an offering for Church World Service. So if you're counting there, there's three. We'll also have a box in the back if you would just like to give a free will offering for the choir there. So we'll have our general offering, our Church World Service offering for communion, and during the kids singing, if you would like to give then or in the box in the back, that'll be just fine. And one last, two more things, just an opportunity to get involved in what God's doing here in Sheldon. On June 30th, we're hosting the guys from the Regional Transition Facility. These are guys who are transitioning out of prison. We're hosting a barbecue for them. And if you're a good barbecuer, we need barbecuers. If you just like good food and can talk it up with the guys, we need people like that too. So you're all invited. Call the church office, right on the back of the communication card. Did you want to be involved with that? And we'll get you connected. And then lastly, this. With great joy, I'm going to cry. Sorry. Because I've prayed long and hard for one couple in our church. And through some painful times and painful realities, God has finally given to Jason and Amber Groendijk not just one kid, but two. A little Hudson, let's see. Hudson Keith and Harper Joy. I'll let Jason and Amber share their story as they want to share their story. But we rejoice today with these two little kids that God has given them. The scriptures say Anyhow, it's the prayer I've been praying. He makes her a joyful mother of children, and that's what He has done. The Lord hears and answers our prayer. So friends, let's stand with me. And you're going to, I want you to sing with me. If you know this song, sing along with me. If you don't know this song or this chorus, just listen to those who are around you. Would you do that? All right? Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. And we bless you, O God. You are the King and ruler of the universe. To you be all glory, honor, thanks, and praise. And Lord, from our hearts and out of our lips, receive glory unto your name. And then we pray that you would inhabit the praises of your people. We love you. We bless you. In your great name we ask. Amen. Amen. Friends, find someone behind you, in front of you, beside you, to the left of you, to the right of you. Welcome them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, let's gather our voices as well as our hearts together to sing praise to the King today. And we look forward to hearing the kids sing praise to Him as well. But let's lift our voices to Him. Let's sing, "To God be the glory." And Lord, we praise you that by the death of your dear Son, Lord, you have rescued us, you have ransomed us, you have bought and paid the price for us. We thank you, Jesus. You paid the price that was ours to pay. You endured the wrath that was ours to endure. You are the one, Lord, who redeemed us. You are the one who reconciles us. Lord, you are the one who has forgiven us by the shedding of your blood. And on top of this, you are the one who rose again from the dead for us. And to you be all glory, honor, thanks, and praise. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, honor and glory and praise. We love you, Lord, and we lift our hearts to you today. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Friends, please be seated. We're going to turn our hearts to prayer here, and there's a couple of people we need to remember to pray for. We're going to remember to pray for Jason and Amber because their life just changed big time. All right? So we're going to pray for them. A couple other needs. Harold Van Veldhuizen has been in and out of the hospital this past week with some pretty serious issues. You can read a little more in the worship bulletin about that. We're going to pray for Harold. Jeff Van Rokel is doing well. I've gotten reports from Shelley. He had back surgery. He's doing well. Cheryl Wolthuizen had knee replacement surgery. We're going to pray for her. There was a little more damage than expected, but God's bringing healing to her. And let's remember to pray for our youth group. Let's remember to pray for our church as we work through the work of Vitality. And, you know, as we're in the middle of this election season, we just need to continue to remember to pray for our nation as well. So let's turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer. Please pray with me. Lord, we love you, and we lift our hearts to you today. And we bring you our prayer, Lord, because you're the only one who can do anything about it. Your word says, cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Lord, you say, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, bring your requests to God. And so, Lord, we bring our requests to you. And these corporately, Lord, that we speak, but Lord, each of us carries on our hearts some great need that we need you to come and rescue or help or deliver or save. Lord, we remember Jason and Amber, and we just rejoice, oh God, for the two little kids that you've given to them. Beautiful kids. Thank you, God. And thank you, Lord, that you have been with them through painful times, but you take tears of sorrow and you turn them into joy. We love you, Lord. We love you. And so we lift them up, Lord. They're going to need the help of family. They're going to need the help of friends. It's one thing to bring a baby home for the very first time. It's another thing to bring two babies home, Lord. And we pray that, Lord, you would give them all grace and that we would look for the ways we can help them as well. Lord, we lift up our brother Harold to you, and we pray that you would stretch out your hand, Lord, upon his body and bring the necessary healing. Lord, it's all kind of a complication of cancer treatment in the past that's still somewhat harming the future. Lord, would you stretch out your hand upon Harold and bring normalcy back to his body once again? We lift him before you. God, we pray for our brother Jeff. Thank you for the surgery that he could have. Lord, we're praying that it would be the end of the pain. He's been suffering for quite a long time. It's been months. And we've been asking. And now, Lord, we pray that this would be the end and that you would bring healing to him and relief for the pain. And I thank you, Lord, for Shelley and her tireless commitment to the vows, Lord, that she made to Jeff and sticking with him, helping him, caring for him. You know, in sickness and in health. Thank you, Lord. She's an example to all of us. And Lord, we lift up Cheryl Wolthuizen this morning and praise you for a successful surgery and pray that, Lord, you would give her strength and determination to persevere through the pain and the therapy that's necessary. Thank you for Bob and Marlis who are helping to care for her, Lord, in these early days and weeks. Please, Lord, bring your healing and relief from the pain for Cheryl this morning. And God, we've got a crew of kids leaving this week with Justin and Jake and Kinley. Lord, they're headed to the Dominican, and we pray that, Lord, you would go with them, that you would keep them safe, keep them from harm. We pray that, Lord, you would use them in ways they have no, of which they do not know now, in ways unexpected, and that you would show up, Lord, in great ways. And in these young people's lives, Christ, we pray that you will continue to work and call them to deeper and deeper commitment and service unto you. And for all of our youth, Lord, from middle school to high school, Jesus, we pray that you will continue to work in their hearts and draw them deeper with you, Christ, where they may know your truth, but not just know it in their heads, but it would transform their hearts. And transforming their hearts, Lord, their speeches change, their actions change, their character changes. Transform these kids. And Lord, we pray that they would know you, love you, serve you, and be willing to forsake all others for the sake of you in their lives. So maybe some of them go to college, but Lord, they don't do the regular route of finding a great job and living a luxurious life. but they want to follow you, Jesus. Some of them maybe won't go to college, and that's fine, Lord. May they just serve you wherever you place them. And what other occupation or whatever function in life you have for them, that they may serve you. We lift them up before you. And God, we pray for the work of vitality that you're working in this congregation. Thank you for our vitality team who's continuing through their functions and work. Thank you for what you're doing. Lord, we pray in the end that you would give us a clear plan, and your direction for us. And Lord, with one heart and as a united body, that we may pursue you towards that end and that goal. Lord, we lift it up. And today, Lord, we want to say thank you as well for our dads. For the dads here present, some who have turned into grandfathers, some who have become great-grandfathers. Lord, thank you for our fathers. There's things we've learned from our fathers that we may not have ever learned from our mothers. And we thank you, Lord, for their strength. We thank you, Lord, that they've for their tenderness. We thank you, Lord, for how they have taught us about you. Thank you, God, for our dads. And Lord, help each father here to be a reflection of you, O God. And both your love like a mother and your strength like a father. Lord, help our dads to reflect you to their children, their grandchildren, and Lord, certainly to the world around them. And Father, we ask too, for all of us who have lost our fathers, that you would be so gracious and so very kind and help us to grieve on this Father's Day. You know, all these flowers up front are in memory of fathers, some who are here, some who have gone. But we want to say thank you, Lord, whether our fathers are still present on earth or who have gone, we thank you for them. We love you, Lord. You have poured out blessing upon blessing. And you've shown that blessing to us and our dads. Thank you. And Lord, we bring this prayer before you, but you know, each of those prayers that we have as we gather, they're on our hearts, they're on our minds, Lord, and we pray that you will answer according to your good, perfect, and pleasing will. Jesus, we lift our hearts to you. In your great name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, friends, we're going to continue our series we started for the summer last week on the book of Jonah. As we kind of turn our hearts there, I want you to take 30 seconds to your and turn to your neighbor, either left or right. Don't leave anybody out. And for 30 seconds, I want you to give each other one word that describes a sailor in every appropriate language, please. That's a joke, but there is a joke that goes around. Okay? On 30 seconds, on your mark, get set, go. One word to describe a sailor. Okay, 15 seconds. Hurry it up. Five, four, three, two, one. All right. Seasick. I didn't even have to ask, and somebody's already given it back to me. All right, I got seasick. Shout out something else. Swimmer. All right, I heard something over here. Adventurous, absolutely adventurous. All right, how about a couple more? All the way in the back, somebody. Smelly. You know, I've heard sailors don't take showers very often. I've been on like a submarine. The captain of the submarine, he's got first dibs on the showers, and the guy on the bottom of the pool, it might be a while. Yeah, smelly. Okay, I hear you. Somebody, one more. Scared and what? Active? Yeah. Okay. You know, I think those are all great things to describe sailors. Anybody here been in the Navy? Or boats? Okay, Dan, yeah, a few guys, Navy guys. Oh, yeah, Edgar, yeah, you were in the Navy. Those guys are tough guys, aren't they? You know, I really think these guys are the toughest guys because it's one thing to be in the Army where your feet are always on land. You know, the only other scarier part might be in an airplane, but they have parachutes. A sailor, you know, if that ship is going down, they're going down with it. Maybe they, hopefully they have a life raft or a vest of some sort to put on. But you got to be tough. Anybody ever ran in a triathlon? Most people can't do a triathlon. You know why? It's the swimming. We can handle running, and we can handle riding a bike, because if you get exhausted, you just stop. You maybe just stop running and walk, or just stop altogether, and you're fine. You stop swimming, and you sink. My wife, Courtney, has done a few triathlons, and I'll brag about her. You know, she can do that for a mile and not sink. I can do that for 10 yards and not sink. So these sailors, what I'm going to get across is, these sailors are tough guys, but you know, the Lord knows how to get to the heart of a sailor, as well as He knows how to get to the heart of every human being. And today we're going to pay attention to what God does in the life of the sailors who are heading with Jonah, who have picked up Jonah, and are going to this place in Tarshish. God knows how to reach their hearts and turn them to Himself. So I want you to open up Jonah chapter 1. But I want you to make this promise. When you open it up, just put your finger where it's at and close it again. I want you just to listen to the word as I share it with you. We'll open it up together and look at the details specifically. But first, I just want you to listen to it, okay? This is how God changes a sailor's heart. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, for its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa and found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he boarded the ship and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. The Lord sent a great wind upon the sea, that such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to their own God. And they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain came to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up! Call upon your God, and maybe He'll take notice of us, and we will not all perish." The sailors said to one another, "Let's cast lots to see who is responsible for this great calamity." Well, they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making this trouble for us? Where do you come from? What do you do? What is your country? From what people are you?" Well, he answered, "I'm a Hebrew, and I worship the God of heaven who made the sea and the land." Now, this terrified them. So they asked him, "What have you done?" They knew he was running away from the Lord because he had already told them so. The sea was getting rougher and rougher. So they asked him, "What must we do to you to make the sea calm down for us?" "Pick me up and throw me into the sea," he replied, "and it will become calm for you, for I know that it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Instead, the men did their best to row back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Then they cried to the Lord, "Oh Lord, do not let us die for killing this man. Do not hold us accountable for taking this man's life. For you, O Lord, have done as you pleased." And then they took Jonah and threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. But the Lord provided a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the fish for 3 days and three nights. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Gert, please pray us in.
Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we especially thank you today for the sunshine. We thank you for the gift of our fathers that you have given to us, and help us to always remember them. And now, Lord, we especially thank you for Pastor Paul, and will you send the Holy Spirit upon him, that the words that come from his mouth are the words that you have chosen. And help us to focus, eliminate all noise and distractions, that we might focus on what you have to share with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Great. Thanks, Kurt. Sailors are tough guys. There's other tough guys. You got Army Rangers. You've got Navy SEALs. Those are the tough guys. You've got UFC fighters. You've got football players. You've got tough people. You know what? God knows how to touch their hearts and reach their hearts. But God knows how to reach fathers' hearts and mothers' hearts and kids' hearts and grandfathers, uncles, aunts, you name it. God knows how to reach people's hearts. And he turns the hearts of people to himself. Now picture yourself that day. You're one of the sailors on the ship. Can you do that? You see this guy with a bit of distressed look on his face come down to the port looking for a ship for Tarshish. You hear him say, I want to go to Tarshish. And you see him talking to the captain. How much is it going to pay? And this guy pays the fare. He gets on the ship. You're just thinking, I'm doing my job. I'm loading cargo on the ship. We're going to Tarshish. I'm going to be back, honey, in about 10 days or so. Well, it's probably a little longer than that. And everything's going to be fine until you get out into the open sea and this great storm arises. Up until this time, life was completely normal. Life was completely predictable. It was the same old, same old. You've even seen storms before, but you've never seen a storm like this before. Did you catch it? I mean, Jonah's just trying to run away from God, but this is the very thing that then God uses to begin to turn the hearts of these sailors to him. Now, we know that he does it in the end. I'm going to jump all the way to the end. Did you notice at the very end, when they throw Jonah into the sea, I mean, and instantly, and the raging sea grew calm. That is in verse 15. The raging sea grew calm. At this, verse 16, it says, the men greatly feared the Lord. All right? They know who he is, and they're fearing him. On top of that, they offer sacrifice to the Lord. I mean, this is an act of devotion. And they made vows to him. These hearts of these sailors have greatly changed. What did God use to change their hearts? And thus, what does God use to change our hearts and the hearts of those around us as well? Let's take a look at that together. We're going to walk through this rather quickly. Here's the first thing. The Lord uses space, time, and circumstances of life to change heart. He'll even bend space, time, and circumstances to make this happen. These sailors, they thought it was just a normal day. We're going to go to Tarshish. We're going to unload the cargo in this guy, and then we're going to come back with another load. They thought it was normal. But God puts the right people in the right places at the right time. You ever heard of a coincidence? You know what a coincidence is, right? Did you know they don't really exist? They really don't exist. Why? They're really just appointments. Take a look at the book of Esther in the Bible. You don't have to go there right now, but read it when you go home this afternoon or sometime this evening. You'll find one curious thing. It never speaks of the Lord one moment, not one time. You don't hear the Lord said this. They don't even say anything about the Lord. Where do you see the Lord at work? And all of the coincidences, the right times, the right places. God uses these things and puts the right circumstances in place. These sailors on that ship with this guy who's fleeing from the Lord because he's setting up all that he needs to turn their hearts to him. So he uses space, time, and he'll even bend space and time to make it all happen. And you look back on it and think, that was weird. It wasn't weird. That's just God doing what God does to get done what he wants to have happen. We don't know at the very beginning that God is doing this, but we find out along the way this is indeed the plan, not only to save send the message to Nineveh, but also to save these people's hearts. So, number one, it's circumstances God uses. But then there's this. The Lord uses the knowledge, or we could also say the awareness of who he is. All right, did you pick it up? When they asked, you know, the lot falls on Jonah, and then they asked Jonah, okay, tell us, who is responsible for making this trouble for us? You know, what do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? Who are your people? And he gives them this response: I am a Hebrew that identifies him with a particular people group, and I worship the God of heaven, okay, who made the sea and the land. Now, if you're a sailor, you would really want to know the God who made the sea, right? Now, these guys are pagans. Up until this point, they're all calling out to their gods, and they'll call upon the God of the sea if that's necessary to save their own tails. They will do that because they know they're in trouble. And Jonah gives the revelation of who God is. He's the God who's in heaven. He's over all. He's the God who made the sea and the land. Guys, you're talking to the most powerful God. But it's not just merely having the knowledge, but then they also have to see it in action as well. But let me give you this encouragement, friends. Sometimes when we want to share the good news of the gospel with people, we want to tell people about who God is. You know, it's not us to do the persuasive work. It's mostly us to take this knowledge and just spread it like seeds. If you've ever put new grass into your yard, if you've not used sod, but you've just spread the seed, you'll use one of these little whirligig things, and it just sows the seed everywhere, and you get a nice coverage on the ground. And that's all our job is. The persuasive work, and God does this in the story with the circumstances and all that happens, the persuasive work is done by God's hand as people move in and through their hearts. God does this work. He's the one who changes and transforms. Now, this knowledge has to be applied. It has to be put to use by trusting in faith. But you can't have just faith without an object. You have to know what you're putting your faith in. You can't have faith in faith. So people must have knowledge, and it's up to us to scatter that knowledge. And Jonah's doing it, not perhaps intentionally, but he's making it happen. So the Lord uses space-time circumstances. He also uses the knowledge and awareness of who he is. Now, there's more to this then. This is really, really interesting. And I love this aspect. Did you notice the change in who these sailors are crying out to? At first, when they realize they're in deep trouble, that they're crying out to their gods. And even the captain of the ship says to Jonah, how can you sleep? Get up. Call upon your God. Maybe he'll take notice of us, indicating that the gods of the sailors haven't done anything yet. Maybe he'll take a notice of us and we will not all perish. These sailors are seeing the failure of their gods, their idols, and nothing's happening. They're calling out and it's failing. Did you notice that when they found out what was supposed to happen to Jonah, they don't do it right away? He said, pick me up and throw me in the sea and it'll become calm for you. But then it says, the scriptures say in verse 13, instead the men did their best to row back to land. They tried to do it themselves and they could not do it. So God uses the failure of gods. He uses the failure of idols. He even uses the failure of one's own efforts. So we all ultimately come to that place to say, I can't do it. You know, it reminds me of a story I heard from, I believe it was David Bast. And David Bast is the president of Words of Hope, which is the radio ministry of the RCA. And he told the story once bringing us a story told by one of the Iranian producers of a pastor in Iran who was leading a house church. And the government knew about him. Now, if you know about Iran, this is a no-no. You do not do this. This is not good. And one of the chief policemen, or maybe it was a bodyguard of a high-ranking official, knew about this pastor's house church. And one evening, there was a big knock at the door. Thunk, 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 thunk. You know, they weren't expecting anybody, so they're a little bit nervous. And they go to the door, open the door, and there are two official men there from the government who said, come with me. And the pastor looks at his wife and they look at each other. They said, now. So he went and he got in the car and he's heard the stories of how this goes from many others in the past. You get in the car and you don't come back. But instead, they've pulled up to a house. Get out of the car. He gets out of the car. Follow us. They led him to the house. They knocked on the door. The door was open. And here stood this man that the pastor knew, this large man. He was a government official, bodyguard, something to that degree, or head of the police. I can't remember the details exactly. And in his Farsi language, say, "Are you a pastor?" And of course, yes. He didn't want to deny what God had done in his life to bring him to be pastor. "Do you know how to pray?" "Yes." "Do you believe God can heal?" "Yes." "Come with me." And he brought him upstairs to his son's bed, and there his son was lying sick and dying. "Pray for my son. If God can heal him, he'll do it." And the pastor's kind of resisting. "Well, I don't know if God will heal him." "Well, can't your God heal?" "Well, yeah." "Well, then pray." So what did he do? He prayed. And you know what happened? Well, the pastor left. And the next day, the son woke up. He was healed. And you know what happened to that dad? Who was a Muslim man, part of the Iranian government, and a big shot? His heart was turned. Because God uses the failure of gods. God uses the failure of idols. God uses the failure of our own efforts to bring us to that place to turn our hearts to Him. The Lord knows how to turn the hardest of hearts. You know, and fathers, He knows how to turn your heart. Mothers, He knows how to turn your heart. Kids, He knows how to turn your heart. He knows how to turn the hearts of the hardened Army Ranger, the Navy SEAL. He knows how to turn the hearts of the most hard-headed UFC fighter. You name it. God knows how to turn their hearts, and He does it. He's the one who turns hearts of people to Him. And He does it to these sailors, friends, and He wants to do it to you today. There was another story. This is a personal story of mine. I was flying from Minneapolis to Seattle about 3 years ago. And sometimes, you catch a break when you're flying. You know what I'm talking about? You catch a break. I was supposed to be seated about 14 rows back. However, because I was flying by myself, and there was a family who was separated, the stewardess came to me and said, "Sir, would you like to sit in the front row?" "Sign me up, baby." I said, "Sure, I'd like to sit in the front row. I know what it means. You get off the plane a lot earlier than everybody else." So I said, "Sure." I grabbed my bag, headed to the front row. Unfortunately, it was in the middle seat. I usually like to sit in the aisle so I can at least get one leg stretched out in the aisle. But it was the front row, so I'll take what I can get. I sat down, and I was fumbling for a pencil in my pocket. They'd asked me to write something down, I can't remember what, or I wanted to write something down. I turned to the lady next to me, and I said, "Can I borrow your pen?" "Oh," she says, "sure." So I began to write it down, and that began a conversation with this lady. Her name was Cerise Salander from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. I'm not lying! That is not an embellishment. I looked it up last night on my email because we exchanged some email after that. Cerise Salander's from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. I am not lying. That is so true. And if Cerise, you're listening to this right now, you remember the conversation. For 3 hours from Minneapolis to Seattle, we had one of the most wonderful conversations I've ever had with anybody who did not believe. Now, she grew up in a Catholic church, so she had knowledge and awareness, but I don't know if she had a full knowledge and awareness of the love of Jesus, love of God in Jesus as displayed and demonstrated on the cross. She kind of knew that, but she kind of grew up with a form of religion denying its power. But the Lord was using space, time, and circumstances. You see that? When the stewardess came to me and said, "Sir, would you like to move to the front?" I had no control over that. Only the Lord has control over that. But she yet hadn't come to this place. Through our conversation, we had a great one. She yet hadn't come to this place of a failure of God's or of idols, but for her, really, it was her own efforts. But you know, friends, in the course of that conversation, it wasn't about me to persuade her heart. It was about me sowing seeds. And that's just what I did. I don't know today if she's come to believe. I don't know. But if from time to time, if I'm walking through the store, I say, Lord, turn her heart to you. My job was just to sow the seeds. God uses all these things to turn the hearts of people to him. In fact, friends, it is not an accident. It is not an accident that you're even here today. I don't know how you got here. You know, some of you are regularly here on a Sunday morning, so I know how you got here. But some of you are here for Rice Fest. Some of you are here, you know, visiting family. You're here, but it is not by accident. It is not by accident. And friends, today I want you to become like one of these sailors. I want you to surrender to the Lord. I want you to believe and trust in Jesus Christ to save you. Now, these sailors, they're living long before Jesus ever showed up on the screen, on the screen of life. But friends, Jesus Christ has come into the world. And with him comes the kingdom. But through him is entry into that kingdom. And we enter into God's kingdom by simple faith, simple trust, and receive that salvation. When I say trust, I mean it, just trust that he died for our sins. He rose again from the dead. And one day he will come back again. Jesus Christ came so that you could be saved, that your heart would be changed, and that you could be a part of God's great family as well. And today, I want you to become like a sailor. I want you to surrender to the Lord. And I don't know if you've made that decision. You may have grown up in church all of your life. And this head knowledge hasn't become heart knowledge. You've known things, but you've never put it to use. You've never put it to practice. You've never applied it, maybe put faith in an object, that object being the Lord himself. I want you to become a sailor today. You're not here by accident. I'm giving you truth here. God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners and apart from him, Christ died for us. But he also rose again and has given us victory over death in the grave. How are we given victory? Simple, by faith. When we have faith and trust, we're united to him. We're united to him. I want you to become a sailor today. And if today you're making, you know, that response for the very first time to trust in Jesus Christ, I want you to find me. I'm going to be over here shaking hands and just kind of hanging out in this area after worship. I want you to come and find me. I want you, and I want to start you on a path to help you grow in the Lord. I want you to become like a sailor today. Here's the next thing. This is, dads, I want to speak to you very personally for a little bit. You're not dispensable. Our culture teaches that dads are dispensable. You're not. Your children need you to interpret the circumstances of life. Your children need you to be in the Word so that you can know, you know, what God's will is, so that you can interpret the circumstances of life. When these great storms come upon your kids, you can be there to give them wisdom and advice that comes from God's Word. So, but not only do you need to interpret circumstances, you need to teach them the truth of God's Word. You are not dispensable. And I know moms do a great job, but dads, get on the horse and ride. You've got work to do too. Your children and grandfathers, your grandchildren, and great-grandfathers, your great-grandchildren, they need you to interpret the circumstances of life. They need you to teach them the truth and to lean and depend on Jesus Christ for salvation. I will never forget my grandparents. I know they prayed for me. I know my parents did. But they also learned, they taught me to depend on the Lord Jesus Christ too. And fathers, in the times in which we live, there's other messages being filled in your children's heads. And who else is going to stand up? Now, you can have the best youth pastor. You can have the best children's ministry leader. You can have the best pastor here. But unless you're living it at home, it means almost nothing. Now, God does do great things despite us, but he's leaning on you. Those kids in your home are not accidents. Yeah, you might have thought they were, but they're not. That was a joke. They need you. This is serious. This is serious. But friends, here's this is for all of us as well. It's time to come to this table. It's time to come to this table. And at this table, we find grace. Not grace that saves, but grace that sustains. Grace that, you know, God calls to our mind of the broken body of Jesus on the cross for us, the shed blood of Jesus. We need to come to this table. And at this table, we're reminded of what Jesus has done for us. Here it is. When we come to this table, we come in remembrance, we come in communion, and we come in hope. We come in remembrance that our Lord Jesus Christ was sent of the Father into the world to assume our flesh and blood. Pinch your neighbor next to you. All right, go ahead. Softly. You could have done the same thing to Jesus. He had flesh and blood just like ours. He came to assume our flesh and blood and to fulfill all obedience to God's divine law, even to the bitter and shameful death of the cross. But by his death, resurrection, and ascension, Christ has obtained for us a new covenant of grace, an eternal covenant of grace and reconciliation, that we might be accepted of God and never be forsaken by him. That's remembrance. We also come in communion, believing that this bread and this cup are the body and the blood of Jesus. In the bread, he comes to us as the true heavenly bread that nourishes unto eternal life. In the cup, he comes to us as the true vine in whom we must abide if we are to bear fruit. But friends, we also come in hope, believing that this bread and this cup are a pledge and foretaste of the feast of love, of which we also shall celebrate when his kingdom has fully come. Now think about it. On that day, we shall behold him, we shall be made like him, and we shall be, you know, with him and with one another on that great and glorious day when Jesus comes. Now, friends, as we take the elements this morning, we need to remember that by his death, resurrection, and ascension, Christ has obtained for us the life-giving Holy Spirit that unites us all together as one body. So as we take the elements, it behooves us to remember this, that if there's any division between us, we need to be reconciled, as God has reconciled us to himself in Christ. When we come to this supper, this is a supper, this is a table, this is God's reconciling us to him. And today, if you're not in a saving relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ, I would invite you, you may still come forward if you would like. I'm going to be here in the middle. And if you would like to bring your children, you bring your children too. If you come forward, just pass right on by the elements. I'm going to ask you not to take the elements, but receive God's blessing. So if today you're not in a saving relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ, just bypass the elements. If you would like God's blessing, I'll pray for God's blessing. You may bring your children, you know, for the Lord's blessing as well. I'll just pray over them as well. But today I want you to receive Jesus Christ in your heart. And not taking these elements today, I want to prepare you then to be ready to take these elements the next time. As we come forward today, we're going to start in the back, coming up the side aisles, and coming and taking the bread and the cup, and then proceeding back down the center aisles. We got some cordage on the floor. Please watch your step. If you know you may need a little bit of help, don't be afraid to grab an arm, grab a hand around you, okay? We don't want anybody to get hurt. But friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let's pray. Please pray with me. Well, Lord, we lift our hearts up to you, and we give thanks to you, for it is right to give you our thanks and praise. And holy and right it is. And it's our joyful duty to give thanks to you at all times and all places. You are our Lord. You are the Creator. You are the Almighty and the Everlasting God. You've created heaven with all its host, earth with all its plenty. You have given us life and being, and you preserve us, Lord, by your providence. But you have shown us the fullness of your love in sending into the world your Son, Jesus Christ, the eternal Word, made flesh for us and for our salvation. And for the wonderful gift of this precious Savior who has reconciled us, we praise and bless you, O God. And with your whole church on earth, with all the company of heaven, we worship and adore your glorious name. Lord, thank you for this supper in which we remember the perfect sacrifice of your Son offered once on the cross for the sin of the whole world. And in the joy of his resurrection and in expectation of his coming again, we offer ourselves to you, Lord, as holy and living sacrifices. Send down your Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be to us the communion of the body and the blood of Christ. And the grant that being joined together in him, we may attain to the unity of faith and grow up, Lord, in all things. And through Christ Jesus, we ask. And as this grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf, these grapes from many hills into one cup, may your whole church soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, friends, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples saying, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this as often as you receive it in remembrance of me." And after they had eaten supper, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he said, "Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. When the music starts, please start in the back, come down the center aisles, take the elements, and head back down the center aisle to your seats. I'll invite the elders to come forward, and then when Danielle begins to play, just please come, bring your children. I can pray over your children here in the center. Come, for all things are now ready. Let's take some time just to say thank you to the Lord for feeding us at his table. Please pray with me. Lord, we give thanks to you for feeding us here at your table. Your word says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me." Bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who renews your life like wings on eagles. Christ Jesus, we love you that you went to the cross and died for us there. Lord, we give you our thanks and bless you. And help us, Lord, the children are going to sing in just a little bit to celebrate the awesome greatness of who you are, but the great things that you have done for us and your work at the cross. We love you and bless you and thank you. And Jesus, we lift our hearts to you. In your great name we pray. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Well, I'm going to invite the deacons to come forward. We're going to take an offering here, friends, as we sing this next song. The song is Bless the Lord, O My Soul. Bless God's holy name. So I'll ask the deacons in their regular plates will be our regular offering. They'll pass the bag, and that will be our church world service offering. But let's lift our hearts to the Lord and sing. Sing with me.
Worship is holy name.
And all God's people said, amen. Hey, there's some kids in the back who are just as eager as could be to sing for you. And if you were at Rise Fest yesterday, you got a little bit of taste, a little bit of flavor of what that's going to be. So I want to introduce to you, in celebration of what Christ has done for us, his death and resurrection from the grave, I want to introduce to you the His Little Feet International Children's Choir. So without any further ado, children, we're ready. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Raise your hand if you wish you had that much energy right now. Anybody else? All right. Oh, a few double handers there in the back. Well, me too. Well, my name is Mike Hahn. This is my wife, Krista, and we're the founders and directors of His Little Feet. We're so excited to be here. We're so excited just to see how God is going to continue to speak to your heart this morning. And we have literally brought the mission field here to you this morning. Behind me, there are 18 children, and they come from India, Ethiopia, and Haiti. And something that you can't tell just by looking at these precious children is each one of these children has lost one or both of their biological parents. Now, that's because of things like lack of clean water, the HIV/AIDS crisis, extreme poverty, abandonment, and for some, even death. However, in each one of these children's lives is also a great testimony of God's grace. And Proverbs 31:8 says that we are to speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. And that's exactly what these children are doing here this morning. That's exactly what they were doing yesterday at Rise Fest. And that's exactly what these children are doing as they travel throughout the United States. These children represent millions of children around the world that don't have a voice. And Jesus said that unless we would humble ourselves and become like little children, we cannot enter His kingdom. So we pray this morning that you're just reminded afresh of what that childlike faith looks like.
Well, as you came in, hopefully you received a His Little Feet brochure. We just want to encourage you this morning that first and foremost, we want this to be a time of worship where we can focus on all that God has done and is yet to do. But also, we want it to be a time for you to prayerfully consider your part in helping with the needs of children around the world. And so inside this brochure, there's four ways listed there that we want to encourage you as the body of Christ to take some steps. And so if you can open that up right now, I just want to have you glance at the four ways that we as His Little Feet create as kind of a launch pad for people to get involved. You'll see them listed there: give, sponsor, go, and adopt. And we have lots of wonderful resources out in the foyer. What do we call this area over here? The
Fellowship Hall,
that after the service today, we'd love to connect you with if you're interested in sponsoring or going on a mission trip or in adoption. And also later in the service, you'll have an opportunity to give to the ministry of His Little Feet, and inside this brochure is the envelope to give. And so we want to just continue our time of having the children come and share more about who they are. So will you welcome back with me the children as they come and introduce themselves?
I'm 12 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Dirsha. I'm 11 years old. I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is Anouk. I'm 11 years old. I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is Jessica. I'm 10 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Laya. I'm 11 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Corey. I'm 9 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Brooke. I'm 11 years old. I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is Bwangi. I'm 12 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Buruk. I'm 8 years old. I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is Kebru. I'm 11 years old. I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is Biniam. I'm 11 years old. I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is Dee. I'm 12 years old. And I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Kima. I'm 14 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Ntayo. I'm 12 years old. And I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is MSA. I'm 12 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is David. I'm 12 years old. I'm from India.
Hello, my name is Ayantu. I'm 12 years old. I'm from Ethiopia.
Hello, my name is Donaldson. I was born in Oba, Haiti, and I am 10 years old.
Behind us are our friends from India, Ethiopia, and Haiti.
Together, we are His Little Feet.
We are so thankful for this opportunity to worship the Lord and share our lives with you.
When I was 4 years old, my father abandoned me. My mother was very poor and unable to take care of me at that time. So she took me to Christian orphanage where I am loved and cared for and taught about Jesus Christ. Today, I love riding bikes, singing, and playing football. Someday, I want to become a doctor. I want to become a mechanical engineer.
When I was 3 years old, my parents left me with my auntie and never returned. From a very young age, I was passed around from one place to another, not careful, well, and unable to go to school. I ran away from my difficult situation and ended up at the police station. I went placed in the children's home where I was safe, got to attend school. And I was introduced to Jesus Christ. Today I enjoy go to school, singing and playing with my friends. Someday when I grow up, I want to be a doctor.
When I was born, my father bedded my mother and I. Later, my mother became very sick and lost her sight. We were left to beg on the streets of Haiti. At the age of 5, my mother passed away. I was placed in a Christian orphanage. Shortly after that, adopted by a loving Christian family. Today, I love traveling, watching football, and riding my bike. When I grow up, I want to become a missionary doctor and help sick people all over the world.
Isaiah 40, verse 31. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagle. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
1 John 3, 1. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God.
Romans 15, 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him.
Thank you.
Alive, alive, forevermore. Oh, Jesus is alive. Alive, forevermore. Oh, Jesus is alive.
I just wanted to remind you of the significance this morning. God has brought the fatherless to lead us in worship this morning. And what a privilege it is. Krista and I, we have seven other staff members that get to pour into these children for 10 months' time. And in 2009, I wanted to share just in 2 minutes our story. In 2009, I heard that there was 143 million orphans in the world. That's the best statistic they had at the time. And it was one of those numbers that kind of came in one ear and went out the other. It was too big. I didn't know what to do with it. And I didn't want to have to do much, but it bothered me a little bit. So for 3 weeks, I couldn't sleep at night. I'd wake up in the morning thinking about 143 million. And so after spending some time in prayer, I was driving down the interstate in the East Coast, and I felt God say, Mike, if there's 143 million children without parents and without advocates, what are you going to do about it? And see, I'd realized that for years I was the excuse maker. So if I heard about a child in need, oh, the Jones family, they could help. There's a mission trip. Oh, that Williams family, yeah, they'd be good. They'd be good to go. Oh, 143 million orphans. Boy, the government, they really should be doing more. And so I was the king of excuses, and God gently that day reminded me that He was making me aware of a need so that I would do something. He's showing me so that I will respond. Right now, there are almost 500,000 children in the U.S. foster care system. So that's children, they're right here in our backyard. Many of them need families, and all of them need to see and experience the love of Jesus Christ. So back in 2009, we took our life savings and did something crazy, and we felt a real clear burden that we were to bring the mission field to the and also go to the church, the Christians. See, as Christians, we're followers of Jesus, and when you're following Him, a lot of times there's great cost. There's cost to your comfort, cost to your time, cost of your money. There's a cost to following Him. However, we're the ones that are privileged to answer the call. And there's 18 testimonies that are standing behind me right now. They're a beautiful picture of stories of children who've been helped, who've been rescued. And now they're able to sing to their Heavenly Father because they know Him. And so this morning, I don't know how God's speaking to you, but I would just encourage you. Say, Lord, what's my part? Maybe I can't help 143 million, but maybe I could start with one. Would you show me my one? So that's just my encouragement to you this morning. I'm going to invite Pastor Paul to come, and he's going to let you know how you can give. And we just want to say thank you, Pastor Paul, and to all the host families that have so graciously opened up their homes to house these children. I know some of the kids on the stage took some of their first tractor ride here yesterday, and it was quite the experience. There's a lot of fun stories just from being here, so thank you so much.
Tractor rides, four-wheelers, I've heard a lot. Yeah. I've heard a lot. Say, we're going to take a little offering while the kids are going to sing. You know, you can use this little envelope in the back. If you came today thinking, boy, I'd like to do something, but, you know, I didn't come prepared, you can drop this in the mail just as well. So let's give the deacons a hand because they're working really hard this morning, huh? I'm putting them to the test. Thanks, guys. While the kids sing, we're gonna take a little offering. And there's a free will box in the back. If you miss this one, there's a free will box in the back. But thanks, deacons, for helping out. Kids are gonna keep singing, and we're gonna respond with giving too, guys. Thanks a lot. Let's listen to the kids.